Okay, good morning. Today is Thursday, November 4. How about that? And this is class 22, series on Nisargadatta Maharaj teachings after the long stories of reminiscences of David Godman and G.K. Damodaro Rao's biography, which was very interesting too. Approaching the end of the first half of the 200 quotations, his direct teachings, second part of the page, innerquest.org, Nisargadatta MG, Maharashtrian Yogi, Arjani. Last week we ended at passage 84, and I'll repeat it again. Again, what I see here is his own expression of the attainment akin to Ra's statement that the crystallized healer has no will and is fully living in accord with a natural flow of phenomena, including mind process and expression associated with relationship and interaction. And like the autonomic nervous system, as I talked about before, where much of the body is homeostatic mechanism of continuing its own well-being, of self-healing, self-corrective mechanisms of body to keep balance and keep the body going. That the mind has that autonomicity available to autonomicity, self-nomos, the I-nomos, the law of one's own law, very much like Svabhava, own being, own becoming. The mind has that too, and phenomena or our war or life in society has that too. Meaning, we go through the day, the body makes various changes, and so it gets hungry, we eat. When it's tired, we sleep. When it's thirsty, we drink. Cold, we put on clothing. Hot, we take off. Or dirty, we wash. And after wash, we dry. Dot, dot, dot. Same thing with the mind. Same thing with the phenomenal occurrence around us in their own natural way. And what's said and done with the individuals around us as well. In accord for him with service and non-duality. And that's much of what he'll be explaining in the passages to be read today. And the perspective of the Yani who's freed from bonds of identity, dualistic subjective identity. So I'll just jump in, and some of these, the translations are always variable and questionable. Some words that are some of the translated words are probably non-optimal, so could be translated better. But the points are pretty clear. 84, Nisargadatta said, "Being nothing, I am all. Everything is me, everything is mine. Just as my body moves by mere thinking of the movement, so do things happen as I think of them. Mind you, I do nothing. I just see them happen. I accept and I am accepted. I am nothing, and nothing is not afraid of nothing." And again, as I said last week, nothing means no thing. It doesn't mean void of all power, like the void before the plenum is the void. The no thing is full of power and potential. And so I am no thing means he's not identifying as a thing or with things of body, mind, or personality. And therefore there's no fear. And that's fear as the final, one of the final barriers broken. 85. "Just as the taste of salt pervades the great ocean, and every single drop of seawater carries the same flavor, so every experience gives me the touch of reality, sat, the ever-fresh realization of my own being. So again, like 84, he's saying the outer is the inner. Everything is me, everything is mine. The I pervades all. Now, to say me and mine, I might cringe, but he doesn't mean me personally, my personality. He means everything is of this I, everything is of this I. Everything that is of the nature, of the same nature as this one here, like that, I think. So every experience gives me the touch of reality, ever fresh realization of my own being. Now, if that's reified or hypostatized, I forgot that word, but to think on this regularly, oh, every day I'm looking around and I see the realization of my own being. This is attachment to, thought. And I don't think that's what he's doing. So, the phrase here, my own being, may actually be something like Swabhava. Every experience gives the touch of Sat. Every experience gives or is of, and the translator may have put gives me. Maybe. I don't know. I don't think Isagadatta is heavily me. But likewise, the final phrase, the ever fresh realization of my own being, could have been ever fresh realization of self nature, not my own being. Self nature doesn't mean my own being. It's not a thing that I, as another thing, is owning. And that's the point. And people get stuck in spiritual grandiosity, spiritual inflation, to identify as non-duality. To make a non-duality an identity is a problem. Non-duality is not an identity. And as I was saying to somebody in a session just the other day, as far as I know, as far as I experienced, whatever that was, the deathless and absolute freedom is inconceivable. There's inconceivability in it. It's an incons and it, it's a it, if it's temporary, I would imagine, as far as I know, its nature is inconceivability. Not simply we can't conceive of it, but in it there's no perception, there's no sankhara, there's no conceiving occurring, and it's so existence beyond conceiving. There's no conceiving. Gautama said that complete and perfect enlightenment, there's the cessation of cessation of perception and consciousness. Okay? So non-duality, real attainment, final, complete, perfect enlightenment, attainment of non-duality is a non-arising of perception and subjective consciousness, which includes non-arising of conceit or conceiving. So that the liberated condition or liberation is of inconceivability. There's no conceiving occurring. It just doesn't occur because perception doesn't occur because there's no identification of a separative selfhood that operates by way of a perception of apparent objects. That whole subject-object situation is finished. And so likewise conceiving too. 86. Nisargadatta said, "Of course, you are and I am, but only as points in consciousness. We are nothing apart from consciousness." Now, whether he meant chit or sat, or not sat, but chit, or I don't know if he's ever used buddhi, but we'd have to find the original Sanskrit or Marathi for that. So I'll repeat. Of course, you are and I am, but only as points in consciousness. We are nothing apart from consciousness. This must be well grasped. The world hangs on the thread of consciousness. No consciousness, no world. So there are a few different Sanskrit words that he might be speaking in Marathi for the word consciousness in English. Consciousness in English could be manas. The words for consciousness awareness could be manas or manasik, could be buddhi, and that duality of manas buddhi is important, certainly in Nityananda's teaching. It could be vijnana, which is it's intrinsically measuring-based identification, subjectivist consciousness, or chit. And so chitta, chit, chid, chit, with a T or a D, as sat chit ananda, the chit of sat, the awareness of reality, absolute truth. We're talking trans-subjective, non-dual. So if you're going to be talking, using the word chit as sat chit ananda, as any Advaita Vedanta teacher would be using to associate with the completed awareness state, then this highest nature, that the essential nature of a being, would be chit, or their knowing, the vidya, the Mahavidya, Mahavid, Avadhut Mahavid is Satchit or Tatsat. And awareness of tatsat, suchness, thusness, as it is, reality, absolute truth, absolute non-dual reality. Then we use the word chit. So I think, who knows what word was used here, and translators are, not yogis, not yanis normally. So the world hangs on the thread of consciousness, no world, right? So as subjectivist consciousness, and so that's the problem. We're nothing apart from consciousness. We, as a separate of self, is based on subjective consciousness, which is vijnana, as well as manas buddhi. There's a path of buddhi. At the end, there's no buddhi. There's just chit. So if you want to think that way, you have to say we're the subject, the world of dualist, of objects, is born with the contraction of light associated with eighth fetter formation. Which is ultimately leading to, is aham kar, the aham kar, karma of aham, the making of an I is the establishing of subjectivity. That makes objectivity, or the realm of so-called objects, meaning world. So no subjectivity, no realm of objects, no time and space with identity, subjective, vijnana, manas buddhi. Sense of self-based consciousness, then comes the realm of objects, and that's the realm of dualistic, experience. 87. A life lived thoughtfully in full awareness is by itself Nisarga yoga. And Nisarga again means naturalness or natural. It also means relinquishing or letting go. It can actually also mean shitting. Meaning voiding, excrement. He doesn't mean shit yoga. He means fully released and thus natural yoga. Living in spontaneous awareness, consciousness of effortless living, being fully interested in one's life, all this is implied. And again, translators degrade the non-dual awareness-based words of teachers like Nisargadatta. That's why it's so important. I mean, even with Nityananda, Captain Hattangi's translation is not the same as Voice of the Self. So that's just what happens. Fully interested in one's own life. If you walk around thinking, I'm fully interested in my own life, that's fine. That's nice. It's better than being out to lunch and asleep at the wheel and ignorant of what's happening and not present. But non-duality is not associated with the sense of I am here fully interested in my own life, thinking about it hard day by day. That's not quite what complete and perfect enlightenment appears to be. But yeah, life ought to be lived thoughtfully when thought is needed. In full awareness would be the final goal. Nisarga, that itself is Nisarga yoga, the yoga of being attentive and engaged and present, where releasing has occurred, or natural release, or release comes naturally, and one, becomes quite authentic and spontaneous. like he's saying, living in spontaneous awareness. You know, again, translations are lousy. Living in spontaneous awareness. What's spontaneous awareness? How about spontaneously living in unbound awareness? Because unbound awareness is naturally spontaneous. And he'll explain this in the next 188. So Nisarga Yoga, yeah, as non-dual authenticity, as the natural way of, you know, being in harmony with Tao, not willfully opposing, neither grasping nor aversion, middle path, Wu Wei, not interfering, not interrupting, not going against and not exaggerating. It obviously comes with a commitment to honesty and acceptance, accepting what is, and honestly seeing and knowing and speaking is the basis, but it's not the end. So consciousness of effortless living. Well, again, if you're reifying that, if you're thinking, I will now be living consciously with my effortless living, there's just the strengthened sense of separative self. And that's, you know, you can sort of fake it till you make it, but if you're still faking it. So when you make it, you don't fake it. But there is some balance between effort and surrender. And that's a very subtle matter. 88, Nisargadatta said, why should a liberated man necessarily follow conventions? The moment he becomes predictable, he cannot be free. His freedom lies in being free to fulfill the need of the moment, to obey the necessity of the situation. Freedom to do what one likes is really bondage, while being free to do only what one must, what is right, is real freedom. Very deep teaching, and you know, he speaks really, really well, and his attainment is real, and these are great teachings. Why should you follow convention? Well, it's not that liberation wants to break convention either. So there are so-called crazy, you know, emulators of the crazy yogis, people who act kind of crazy as a teacher or as a student, and think that breaking, being anti-conventional, is some kind of freedom. He's simply saying there's no need to follow convention. There's no need, you know, why should a liberated man necessarily go against convention? Why should he necessarily follow convention? Same. No need to be a slave to authority. No need to actually make a profession out of opposing authority, just because it's an authority. So I would imagine the liberated man, or one, the sage, you know, it lives in accord with heaven and earth, like Chuang-tzu said. But that doesn't mean they follow all convention. It doesn't mean that they have the habit only of opposing convention. The moment he becomes predictable, he can't be free. Predictability as routinization, as stuck in one's ways, set in one's ways. That's not freedom either. Freedom lies in being free to fulfill the need of the moment, right? Being quite present. Right, Ra said, love and light go where they're needed, and they're not, and their movement or direction's not planned aforetimes in terms of wanderers. Not most wanderers not having a very fixed life plan narrative in terms of where to go and what to do. Some do, but most don't. Where to go, I'm going to, before the life pre-program catalyst, I'll be going to that place, I'll be there with these people, I'll be doing these things. That's for some, but not for all. And so Ra said, love and light go where they are needed, and their movement or their direction or their activity is not planned aforetimes beforehand. And that's exactly what Nisargadatta is saying, obey the necessity of the situation, fulfill the need of the moment. Freedom to do what one likes is really bondage. Well, in my opinion, if one ends up naturally, without self-coercion, moving towards and increasingly liking what is the necessity of the situation, liking the Tao, I conform my life with my fate. I more and more conform my preferences, or more and more by natural, Nisarga yoga, naturally, by releasing unnecessaries. My preferences accord my life with my fate, with the necessity of the situation and the need of the moment. That's great. So the great freedom would be liking accord with destiny, fate, and the necessity of the situation, the need of the moment. The need of the moment, the necessity of the situation, where love and light is needed, what's right, what's true, what's best, to naturally be of such freedom that one likes that. That's great. So that's an integration between what one likes and doing what one must. I like to do what I must, but it's not a must. It's a choicelessness, you know? Full accord with that, with Tao, with heaven and earth, with, you know, accord with heaven, accord with man. Just like Chuang Tzu saying. I mean, the Tao, you know, the sage that Chuang Tzu talked about in the first seven chapters, the inner chapters of Chuang Tzu, shows the Dunren as a free being, a free man, who does fulfill the need of the moment, does obey necessity of situation. You know, there's certain things he can't help doing. Help what doing? Chuang Tzu said directly. Meaning there's sometimes there's a necessity of the situation. One does what one has to do. One doesn't really want to, but one does it because it's the necessity of the situation. It's the need of the moment. And the real Dunren is happy with it. The real freed Nisarga yogi is so released of unnecessaries and self-conflict and attachments and identifications and kleshas and ashravas and vasanas, their karma so fully fulfilled and ripened, finished, and not made more, that they like doing what they must, or real freedom, the real freedom of doing what's right. They like it. That's amazing, you know, like Nityananda, like Gautama. They're fully in harmony with their life expression, according their life with their fate, and by, you know, great vairagya over lifetimes, obviously, their vasanas, or their, they don't know if they have any vasanas, but their personal preferences now are fully in harmony with according their life with what's best for all. That's a super freedom. 89, Nisargadatta said, take the experience of death. The ordinary man is afraid to die because he's afraid of change. The yoni is not afraid because his mind is dead already. He doesn't think, I live. He knows there is life. There is no change in it and no death. Death appears to be a change in time and space. Where there's neither time nor space, how can there be death? The yoni is already dead to name and shape. Name and shape is namarupa, most likely name and form. How can their loss affect him? The man in the train travels from place to place, but the man off the train goes nowhere, for he is not bound for any destination. He has nowhere to go, nothing to do, nothing to become. The Lin Shi talked about that directly. Those who make plans will be born to carry them out. Those who make no plans need not be born. So the yoni is dead to namarupa. That's the central point here, I think. The yoni, by nisarga, vairagya, naturalistic, unforced, gradual love, wisdom-based renunciation, dispassion, disinterest, detachment, disidentification, has voided and released and gotten rid of all sorts of unnecessaries. Therefore, they don't believe in namarupa. They can do namarupa, or they can do the nama of rupa. They can name. They can talk about this and that. They can identify things. But they know it's a dream. and they don't have attachment as much as we normally do. And by that, then they're living in the deathless just already. Although there's, enlightenment with the remainder, they still have an incarnation. They're not afraid of change because they're sort of in the changeless. They may not even be perceiving change, actually. And so, I don't know. I'm not there. But there's a certain radical freedom. And in that radical freedom, they're not thinking, I live. They're thinking there's life. And they would understand that in a body, out of body, there's life. What do you say to the guy who died and thought he was going to go to the void? Well, you say, you're dead, but you're still living. Sorry, you were wrong. You're dead now, but you're not dead because you're still living. You're just not in that body, and you're in a different dimension. And you better get with the program, otherwise you're going to be suffering more. So there is life is rather than I live is very similar to Nityananda saying this one here rather than I'm here. I'm here, I live. I live, I'm here. Or there's life for this one here. And each one everywhere. So, no change in it, no death, no change because there's no identification with no identity. There's no identification process, so there's no identity. But that doesn't mean they're screaming out of, insanity or something, or they're, zombified. They can do Nama of Rupa, they can accord with Rupa and men, meaning accord, they might look across, they might look twice before, they might look before they cross the street. I hope they will. The Yani, doesn't walk into oncoming traffic. So they can look at the street and understand, well, we call it a street, and for safety, I should wait for the red light. Now, those with, full city complement powers like Nityananda, he can walk right through the street, or he can fly, or he can disappear, or he can ask the train to leave or stop. That's a different matter. So the man in the train goes from place to place, and that's again, the result of holding more than we need. Desire, grasping, aversion, ignorance, the patterns of mind associated with desire and attachment, craving, right? Tanha, and then clinging, and then wanting. And so making plans is making materialist-based plans with ambition is the basis of 3D incarnation. And those who don't make those plans don't incarnate. Now, that doesn't mean if you don't make plans, you'll harvest. It's obviously. The Yani and harvestable to fourth density are different. But Ra had said something like, the less third density exists to learn the ways of love, or the purpose of 3D incarnation. 3D is to learn the ways of love. When they've been learned, there's no more need for incarnation to do that learning because it's been sufficiently learned. So, the Yani's approach to death is, born of his freedom from identification and desire and craving and clinging. And therefore, he tastes the deathless. And that's the changeless. 90, and there's more explanation of the Yani's realization. A Yani's state is not so blind. It tastes of pure, uncaused, undiluted bliss, Ananda. He is happy and fully aware that happiness is his very nature and that he need not do anything nor strive for anything to secure it. It follows him, more real than the body, nearer than the mind itself. You imagine that without cause there can be no happiness. To me, dependence on anything for happiness is utter misery. Pleasure and pain have causes, while my own state is my own, or while my state is my own, totally uncaused, independent, unassailable. If there's nothing, if there's no grasping, there's no losing. If there's no dependence, there's no threat of loss of reliance. So independent means not depending. Unassailable is the result of not identifying and not grasping. Uncaused means not fashioning causes. Not the result of causes, no longer fashioning causes. This is so-called freedom from karma. It's basically no longer of the basic avidya. I mean, you know, complete and perfect enlightenment, really. It's only the arhan, fourth stage awakening in Buddhism, that doesn't make fresh karma. Therefore, this life is the last, and after this remainder of the incarnation, the remainder that is the body's existence as incarnation, when that's finished, the final breath, then there's departure from the octave. So, you know, that's a bit ahead. The yoni is not blind. He's not a dummy. Pure, uncaused, undiluted bliss. And again, this is the difference between the bliss or happiness, the, at least, you know, ananda or sukha. Whether you call it bliss or happiness is, you know, variable. Bliss, I normally think of as a kind of ecstasy. And you don't see, I don't see yogis walking around, you know, vibrating in ecstasy. It can happen in meditation. There's some pictures of Nityananda who looks like he was vibrating in ecstasy, but he ain't talking. He isn't following bliss. The being is finished, or the being is vibrating intensively in ecstatic bliss. Now, that's not the way Nisargadatta walked around. That's not the way Nityananda walked around when they walked around. So I wouldn't use the word bliss, but, you know, everybody's got their own thing. I would call it, you know, profound sukha, or the joy or the happiness of liberation. He's happy. And again, I use these words more carefully. Happy is bliss, is not bliss. But it's whatever, if you call it bliss or happy. It's the happiness that's non-causal. It's a-causal sukha, non-bhava sukha. You know, non-caused, non-causal, non-grasping. It's ultimately actually free of the three marks and three characteristics. So the three marks, three characteristics, anicca, anatta, dukkha, anitya, impermanence, in transitoriness, anatta, no self, or insubstantiality, and then dukkha, stress, suffering, dissatisfactoriness. Complete and perfect enlightenment is not of those three. There is not, doesn't mean it's permanent. It's not a thing, it's not caused, so there's no thing to remain permanently. It's not a thing that is eternally existing substantial, but it's not insubstantial. Likewise, it's not impermanent. So it's not permanent. I mean, again, some Mahayanists fell into what I would say is affirmation, reification of positives, giving positives to the condition of Nibbana. Gautama II and Ra II didn't commonly, in talking about certain higher conditions or intelligent infinity or complete and perfect enlightenment, it's easier to speak more commonly speaking of what it isn't than what it is, because it's not a thing that is, but it's a freedom from all the qualities of the phenomenal world of things that arise, persist, and die, that are causally based, and of the three marks, impermanent, insubstantial, and stressful. So he said, and this is, you know, this is a certain line that we get to and then pass through in soul evolution or during an incarnation or during a series of incarnations, that freedom from desire starts to taste better than fulfillment of desire. You imagine that without cause, there's no happiness, he said. Meaning, you think that happiness is causally based, and that's, it must be, right? You've got to work your plan your work and work your plan, man. Plan your work and work your plan. And then you'll have happiness. Yeah, sure, that's sukha, and it's of the three marks. It's impermanent and insubstantial. And because of that, it's really dukkha. So all the sukha of happiness, of desires fulfilled that are causally based, plan the work and work the plan successfully, then you get the sukha of fulfilled desire. And the sukha being impermanent and insubstantial is really sukha dukkha. It's sukha, but it's sukha dukkha, not sukha sukha. The only sukha sukha with no dukkha is the end of the path, the end of the octave. And that's why it's called happiness or bliss, undiluted bliss. But he's saying dependence on anything for happiness is utter misery. And likewise, the eternal, you know, continual, long pattern and habit and experience of generating desire, fulfilling desire, experiencing consequences of desire, including sukha, that turns out to be impermanent and insubstantial, thus sukha dukkha. The long, long travail of that is wearisome and known so, or it's known as wearisome. And thus, there is a line in evolution where one increasingly seeks to be free of desire rather than fulfill desires. And because the way of the habit, the basis, I mean, I'm not saying you shouldn't do what you want to do. I'm just saying this is true too. Do whatever you want to do is true too. And it'll have consequences. And all sukha, sukha, dukkha. And that's fine. I have desires. But I also do know that there is a happiness of freedom from desire. And like I was talking to a client about, you know, have a Ferrari. One guy was saying, interesting story if you don't mind me saying so, this guy's friend who did really buy a Ferrari, now, when he goes to the restaurant or to the place to have his car parked, his Ferrari, while he goes shopping or eating or this or that, he gives a certain amount of tip. It's something like he gave a $15 tip in his Ferrari to the parking attendant. And while he was driving, when he had previously not such a luxury car, he gave a $15 tip and everybody was happy. Now, he's having the experience that when he gives a $15 tip, the parking attendant looks askance at him and scowls because the parking attendant appears to be thinking, what, you got a Ferrari and you only give me $15 tip, you cheapskate. And so now he's got the dukkha of how some people will demand more and expect more now that he's driving around in the Ferrari as the fulfillment of his desire to work hard, earn the money, buy a Ferrari, yum, I got it. Now he also gets unintended consequences. And that doesn't mean you shouldn't go work, get a Ferrari, go whatever the hell you want to do. That's not what I'm saying. So, you know, people commonly don't listen well in generally in this planet. They don't listen well. I'm not saying you, people listening, don't listen well. I'm saying commonly, people who attack others commonly are not listening well, actually. And so he says, I like this. Why? You hate that? I didn't say I hate that. I said I like this. Is that a problem? Well, when you said you like this, that you know, well, they don't even talk. They're just animalizing. They don't even know that they don't know. And I want to make this point. This is the thought that had fallen from my mind twice yesterday. I heard somebody say, I don't want to believe that. I don't want that to be true. I don't want to believe it. I was a little bit dumbfounded by that. You mean you want to believe what you like? Well, I want to believe what's true. I don't like it. Not I don't want to believe it. There's a difference. I don't like it, but if it's true, I want to admit it. Not everybody makes that distinction commonly, like that example, the person people think, some people think sometimes, I don't want to believe it. Oh, well, that's a big problem, because then you don't want to believe some elements of reality, aspects of reality that are true. I want to believe what's true. And if it's true and I don't like it, I don't like that it's true. I don't like it. Not I don't want to believe it. I don't want to fool myself more than I want to live in a false reality that feels good temporarily in a shallow, stupid way. I mean, it's very shallow. The happiness that comes from folly, it comes from falsity, it comes from deluded belief, being fooled. That happiness is very shallow, very thin sukha and a thick dukkha underbelly. So I wouldn't say I don't want to believe this. I would say I don't want it. But if it's true, I want to believe in accord with truth. I want to know and align my beliefs with what I have discovered to know to be true. I want to know what's true. And if it's bitter, I will say it's bitter, I don't want it, but it's true. So be careful. Some people have this mind of, I don't want to believe that. Oh, well, you want to deceive yourself? You better be sure. A lot of people are ambivalent about self-deception. Not just self-deception. They're ambivalent about whether they want to continue being self-deceiving. Because they want to. Some people want to strongly, strongly want to continue believing what they like. Meaning conceiving and opining as an understanding of phenomena or reality, what they like, what feels good. Well, I like what feels good too. But it feels bad to believe what isn't true. And it feels bad to conform my opinions to my hope when it's not true. When my opinion is mistaken or my assessment is mistaken because I want to believe it. I want to believe. I want to believe. Fuck, you're in big trouble. That is not a strong mind. That's a weak mind. That's a mind that'll stay weak because it has ambivalence about honesty. Love of truth. You know, without love of truth, one perishes. What truth? The truth of what I is. The truth of green, blue, indigo. The truth of, you know, the qualities of heart and discernment, goodness, basic goodness, as Trungpa Rinpoche said. The basic goodness of soul, of human nature, true human nature. Yeah, there's evil, sure, tendencies to that too. But what came before evil? It was only love light. And so, likewise, he says, to me, dependence on anything for happiness is utter misery. So depending on beliefs that conform to what you hope, conforming your belief to your hope and your desire and your feeling is a big, big problem. It's important to know your feeling. It's important to respect and honor your feeling. But don't, if you let your feelingfulness control your knowing, your truthfulness, feeling should not control discernment. Discernment stands apart from feeling. It should be integrated nicely. It can be. But what is, and we ought to know it, then we can feel misery and bitter if it's a bitter truth, and plan accordingly and make changes in the light of reality rather than in self-deception. 91. I may perceive the world just like you, but you believe to be in it while I see it, the world, as an iridescent drop in the vast expanse of consciousness. And again, that consciousness is chit, not vijnana, manas, or buddhi. I may perceive the world just like you. Right, he can see the cars and the street and what's going on around. But you believe to be in it, and I see it as an iridescent drop in the vast expanse of consciousness. It's a nice phrase. You believe to be in it. He knows it is of mind. It's mind-born. It's of awareness. Intelligent infinity is phenomena. the true nature of phenomena and birth and death, and Namarupa is intelligent infinity. 92. I am a dream that can wake you up. You will have the proof of it in your very waking up. But he didn't have any successors, so I'm not sure about that one. I'm a dream. I is a dream. Well, there's, you know, you see, in the end state, in the end deathless, it's not a state. It's not, there's no more permanent, no more impermanence. In, at the end, as far as I could see ahead of me, at the end, this whole talk of I and self is finished. The guardians don't talk about themselves, you know? They just do or know. They know and they do. They are, they know, they do. That's it. Is it blissful? Eh? Is there a being evolving then? Yeah. So I guess there's some kind of sense of identity, a sense of this one, this one here, or those ones there in eighth density. It's just radically, radically expanded from ours. So, 93. How do you go about this finding out? Meaning, how do you go about this finding out, this discovery? By keeping your mind and heart on it. Interest there must be, this is one translator, interest there must be, sounds like Yoda, interest there must be, and steady remembrance. You come to it through earnestness. What is supremely important is to be free from contradictions. Behavior must not betray belief. Tenacity of purpose and honesty in pursuit will bring you to your goal. Turn within. The, or, quote, I am, you know. This is a translator who liked old language structure and style. Be with it all the time you can spare until you revert to it spontaneously. There is no simpler and easier way. This is his teaching of Aham Vichara, you know, self-inquiry, like Ramana Maharshi taught. How do you go about this finding out? How do you go about this attain this discovery, the discovery of, you know, self-realization, and this realization of self, with the capital S, the consciousness only. This is very much like how to attain higher self. It's not the end of the path, as far as I can tell, by the way. Meaning higher self is not the sixth density, is not eighth density. Atman, aham, au, the au, is not intelligent infinity. It's an aspect of it, or a distillation of it. By keeping your heart and mind on it, on what? On self-realization, on seeking this finding out. What finding out? Finding out what I is. Interest there must be, you mean you must have interest, and steady remembrance, you come to it through earnestness. And this is this very delicate, kind of indescribable balance, alternation, interplay between effort and surrender. Earnestness is the earnest, it's, I mean, this is bhakti, bhakti pad, bhakti marg for Nityananda, meaning the path of buddhi, which is discriminative awareness, that knows the difference between buddhi and manas, or lower and higher, or, you know, unity and duality, is very much led by bhakti, a longing, earnest longing for liberation. I really do seek freedom. And you can't seek a thing. If you're seeking self as a capital S, with a capital S like it's a thing, you're not going to get it, because it isn't a thing. It's a freedom from thing. So it's not a thing to be discovered under a rock somewhere. It's not a state of mind. It's not a state. It's a taste of true nature. Of a taste of non-duality. It's not the final non-duality, but it's a taste of non-duality, or, you know, like Ross said, we no longer seek light, we become light. But they become light because of a long process of earnestly seeking light. Seeking light means what? Well, in practice, it's really seeking the activation, what leads, the seeking that leads to the activation of green, blue, indigo. The seeking that is driven by green, blue, indigo. The seeking of healing because one knows one's in pain. The seeking of honesty because one knows one doesn't know. The seeking of kindness because one knows what doesn't, hasn't lived in perfect kindness, meaning to self and other. Now, that doesn't mean sloppy Joe. It means open-hearted presence, you know, able to feel without surrendering, seeing clearly, or speaking firmly if needed. It's not sloppy Joe. And so earnestness, the importance of being earnest, I think it's somebody's play. That is the deep longing for freedom. That is very much akin to essential bhakti. It's not the bhakti of I love my guru. It's I love freedom because I know I'm not there. I love the sukha that I seek because I know I'm in dukkha. I love satvid, you know, reality, awareness, knowledge, because I know how limited my knowing is. But I'm not going to beat myself up about it. And you can't, you know, pull up the seedling and make it bigger. You got to keep watering and protecting and warming and cycles of warm and cool and day and night and water and dry. Lots of cycles, lots of alternation. Give it what it needs, but don't flood it. Don't give too much. Don't give too little. You know, tenacity of purpose, honesty in pursuit. Earnest, that this is a, you know, 93 is really a statement of the way of devotion, the bhakti path, bhakti marg, bhakti pad. It's vishuddhi marga, right? The path of purification. It's the path of fifth ray. It's guided by love-based honesty, or the love intrinsic to honest honesty with self about what really one needs, because one knows honestly how one's feeling. I know I'm not free. I know I regularly go to dukkha. I know that even some sukha, even all my sukha has the quality of dukkha to some degree. That doesn't mean I'm screaming in misery. It just means that there's a difference between the sukha of freedom from desire and the sukha that comes from fulfilled desire. I fulfill my desires, I get sukha dukkha. I'm free of desire. I'm in an equanimity that doesn't have too much dukkha to it. And effort is needed, but surrender, but not too tight, not too loose. The parable of the lute. Not too tight, not too loose, but effort's needed. Surrender is needed, but that doesn't mean no effort. So free, there's a really beautiful statement, 93, all of it. What's supremely important is to be free from contradictions. Free from contradictions also means free from conflict. You can be damn sure that the Marathi word he used for contradictions doesn't just mean contradiction. It also means conflict. It means self-conflict. It means oppositionalism. It means struggling. It means the way, W-E-I, the Taoists rebut and say, wu-wei, not way. Don't make, don't do, don't force, don't interrupt. Free from contradiction, free from struggle, free from grasping and aversion, free from oppositionalism. Opposition to what is. You know, accept what is, expect reality, live in truth, not in fantasy. And if you want fantasy, have some fantasy, but know it's fantasy. That's the truth, that I enjoy some fantasy. Behavior must not betray belief. Beautiful phrase. Act by behavior, which is physical and verbal, and the decisions one makes, not betraying belief or what you know or your understanding. Walk your talk. I had a long talk about somebody about that the other day, too. If you don't walk your talk, you ain't your talk is cheap. Talk is cheap when you for those who don't walk their talk. People say they believe things when they're not walking their talk, or their behavior appears to betray what they claim to believe. They don't really believe what they claim to believe. It's a empty an empty profession of belief. Beware of empty profession of belief. Some people say it's called lip service, paying lip service, the service of a lip, rather than coming from the heart and the gut. It's not in the bones and the blood. It's just from the lip or from the upper throat or the upper lung or the chest. It's not truly deeply integrated. When one's beliefs are truly deeply integrated, behavior doesn't betray those core beliefs, right? And so, don't fool yourself is a good teaching. At 55, 55, turn within the I am, you know. The I am is not an I. It's a presence. It's presence. Okay? It is not a personal. Transpersonal is not a personal. Transpersonal, the I am is a transpersonal. That transpersonal is not a is not of body mind identification. Not a Scott, not a you with your name. It's I is, but it's really presence. And if you try to name it, you won't be able to name it. And if you do name it, you're off the track. And so that's useful. Be with it. Be with what? Be with it all the time you can spare till you revert to it spontaneously. Be with what? All the time, revert to what? Revert to I am. But it ain't just thinking, I am, I am, I am. No. I mean, I had an experience long, long ago, the first time I had it, very clear in college, sitting in Anapanasati, and following the breath, very boring, no sensationalism. And I felt like I sort of passed through the a membrane of my eyes or my face, and I was in the room. This may be like the magical personality coming into the 3D body. It's basically, it was an emergence of presence. It was a very tangible, not by physical touch, but tangibly, qualitatively discernible experience, new experience of emergence of presence. Presence emerged from the face. Oh, I was like, ooh, here I am in the room. Now I'm here in the room. The fuck, what are you talking about? Where were you before? I was lost in thought behind a curtain. Behind a curtain. I had felt like I came through a curtain. Very similar to the out of body I had. But that was visual and this was more kinesthetic. It was an emergence of presence through the face. Here I am. Yeah, I is, said Bosco. Bosco was a man. I knew Bosco in my last life, by the way. I'm not going to talk about it because people get upset, but I knew Bosco in my past life. He said, I is here. And that was it. It was sort of like some kind of presence emerged. It wasn't another entity, it was I. I, the presence of I emerged and came right through the face. Like, what? I'm here in the room. That was my feeling. And that didn't come. What the hell was that? I don't know. I don't know. You tell me. So, I don't know. But I do know that if you keep thinking, I am, I am, I am, who am I? I am, I am, you'll just go endlessly thinking those thoughts. That's not it. But like Weibo Sayadaw knew in the Burmese jungle, long practice of shamatha goes to vipassana if one doesn't get stuck in the higher jhanas. If you're not stuck in a trance and you keep to what, third or fourth jhana, meaning mindfulness, attentiveness, non-grasping attentiveness, On and on and on and on and on and on and on. Curtains fall. Veils drop. Porosity goes to non-veiling. I'm not saying I'm finished at all, but I can see what's ahead of me. I can see what that is. So a little experience of tangible presence emergence would be naturally would have a culmination of a final enlightenment, which is all for all of us. So the emergence of presence comes naturally with the with deepen with un non-controlling prolonged mindfulness, attentiveness, prolonged non-grasping attentiveness, sitting long, long sitting in samatha, samadhi, mindfulness, sati, with a quiet mind, concentrated, clear, quiet, dot, 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 something then breaks and opens and changes and emerges and is incited. There's a inciting occurring. That would finish the path for all of us. So that, but that you can't be with that all the time. So I'm not sure what he means by be with all the time you can spare. I just don't know. And that, that's between he and his guru. And that's where I'm not a teacher of Aham Vichar. I'm not a teacher of Aham Vichar. I don't know that method. I didn't use that method, or I don't use that method. So, but it's obviously not the same as thinking about I am all day long, or seeking, asking yourself, who am I all the time? That's not the case either. So, 94. This will be the last for today. Skill in meditation deeply affects our character. We're slaves to what we do not know. Of what we know, we are masters. Whatever vice or weakness is in ourselves, we discover and understand its causes and workings. We overcome it by the very knowing. The unconscious dissolves when brought into consciousness. The dissolution of the unconscious releases energy. The mind feels adequate and becomes quiet. When the mind is quiet, we come to know ourselves as the pure witness. We withdraw from the experience and its experiencer and stand apart in pure awareness, which is between and beyond the two of experience and experiencer. The knower and the known, nama rupa. The sense of self that does the nama of the rupa, the naming, the proliferation of sankhara, the thought form production, fabrication, fermentation, thinking, naming, identifying, conceptualizing, kalpana, kalpana, of rupa, of the forms of physical objects and people and situations and body process and mind process and ideas, view. All those so-called objects, physical, mental, inner, outer, situational, ideational, all that realm of objects, so-called, apparently, and an experience, a so-called experiencer, an apparently subjective, separative agent doing the nama of that rupa, the realm of form and worlds, world of objects, that's finished. And it's beyond that. It's between that and neither that duality of agent and knowing of an external, so-called external field. And this is the roots of Vedanta. The roots, before there was an Advaita Vedanta, there was Vedanta, which was Advaita by nature. The original Vedanta is Advaita Vedanta. And it's a, what Upanishadic saying. When the knower and the known and the means to knowledge is one, then there is Brahma. And so, when the knower and the known, the so-called self and the apparent field of objects, and the nama, the means to knowing is one, there is Brahma. So intelligent infinity, the complete and perfect enlightenment condition, satchitananda, there's no more distinction of a knower and a known and a knowing process. It's all one and thus none. It's not happening. There's no distinction of subject and object, any means to cognizing the object by the subject. That's not happening. We're going to get back to this 94 to start next class. It's actually a very deep understanding of transpersonal. It's a very fine presentation of transpersonal psychology. Number one, he's talking about meditation. Skill in meditation deeply affects character. Bang. Absolutely. It affects the conscious mind, the subconscious. It is a direct working on the lower triad by means of prolonged, extended, non-grasping attentiveness, mindfulness. Wu Wei is sati, you know. And so, skill in meditation, ya, transforms the personal psychology. It's a transpersonal self-therapy. It's a self-therapeutic, deep healing of the personal psychological, because it's totally affecting the lower triad in terms of the energetics of the chakras involved, particularly long dwelling in unconditional accepting, non-grasping attentiveness, which is very fourth ray. And to whatever extent we're cognizing what is, there's fifth ray, or an honest non-grasping, fourth and fifth, helping to do the clearance of blockage of one through three, the lower triad, by catharsis. And so the dissolution of the unconscious releases energy. Ba-boom. The clearance of lower triad blockages releases energy by what's called catharsis. Catharsis is the releasing of the distortion leavings, as Ross said, of the lower triad blockages by increased voltage of the Kundalini upward spiraling light that is catalyzed by long-term non-grasping attentiveness, mindfulness, meditation practice. And the skill is I can do it longer and more stably, and more has been exhausted, meaning more releases occurred over the time of doing it over years or lifetimes, and there's less distortion leavings to have catharsis, for catharsis, of the catharsis. There's diminished catharsis because it's been catharted. Then he's very clearly talking about common self-understanding. You know, he's not just talking about who is I, aham vichara. He's also talking about the transpersonal approach to knowing one's personal psychology. Whatever vice or weakness is in ourselves, we discover, understand its causes and workings, right? Taking appropriate responsibility, and overcome it, quote, by the knowing. The very knowing is its healing. You know thyself is heal thyself. And the knowing is a love wisdom working, green blue. The green blue, the application of lower triad blockage to green blue, or bringing your pain to love wisdom. Bring your pain and your confusion to love wisdom. And that is a quote overcoming. It's really a healing by love-based knowing, honest knowing. Then the unconscious dissolves when brought to conscious. Yeah, it dissolves. And dissolution of that releases energy. Brilliant. Dissolution of the unconscious. The unconscious dissolves really means the lower triad blockages dissolve. What is the unconscious but lower triad blockages? When they're not blocked, is there an unconscious? No. The seven, the polarity of subdiaphragmatic lower triad and the upper triad, green, blue, indigo, becomes one. Oh ho. And so unconscious becomes conscious as the blockages of the lower triad are released, which is the quote dissolving of an unconscious, which releases energy, which is associated with distortion leaving catharsis, but also it liberates energy, releases energy by the catharsis of the distortion leavings blockages in process of releasing. But it also allows a greater voltage from root to crown. It liberates root chakra. So that greater voltage can go from root to crown. Mind feels adequate and becomes quiet. Mind means sense of self. Mind doesn't feel adequate. Mind becomes stable. The sense of self increases its sense of adequacy. One does no longer hates oneself. One no longer fights oneself. One no longer suppresses emotional process. And so self-conflict ends little by little, and then finally finished. There is no more self-conscious to oppose or suppress. Then becomes quiet. And when the mind is quiet sufficiently, the prolonged quietude, one comes to know oneself as pure witness. And that's similar to emergence of presence. We then withdraw from experience and its experiencer. So the whole notion of me, the doer, and those things, the done, and this process, the doing, all that is ending. And so this is a very brilliant, it's a very brilliant passage, 94. And that's where we'll end for today. That's where we'll pick up next week. And so Nisargadatta rightly, is beloved by hundreds of thousands globally for Tattvamasi, the book, and Maurice Friedman's work, bringing it to the public, and Nisargadatta's brilliant talent of a sage. In many ways, passage 94 here shows a complete presentation of the therapeutics of the work of transpersonal psychology, the karmic activity, or the doing, the performance of deep self-healing by an Advaita Vedanta transpersonal psychology approach, transpersonal approach to deep self-healing from Advaita Vedanta and Nisargadatta, moving from confused wounding to clear non-duality through deep self-healing and peace and insight. So that's it for today. I hope that was useful. Please take good care of yourself. See you next time, and good night.